start now, and with luck we'll keep to time. The title that I gave to this particular talk, and that is entered in the book, is about transitivity and institutional norms of translation. Well, the thing is that my thinking has moved on a little bit since I offered that title to José Lambert, and it's not exactly that that I'm going to give you this afternoon. So my apologies for that, but lest you think that I'm shortchanging you, I think it's probably only fair to give you a flavour of this earlier paper that was called Transitivity and Institutional Norms of Translation by way of an introduction to what I am going to talk about, which is the pragmatics of translation shifts. The two topics are very closely related, and really what I am going to talk about is just an update on the research that I wanted to talk about before. So I'll start by talking about institutional attitudes to translation and then go on to my topic of the pragmatics of translation shifts. And I hope that the unity of all this will become apparent as we go along. Okay. A thought that I've had at the back of my mind for years but never got round to doing anything about was the notion of institutional attitudes towards translation, by which I mean the attitudes of translating institutions towards translation, and not institutions in general. In other words, all of those large institutions which have in-house translators and employ translators on a regular basis, what do they advise their own staff in terms of how one should translate, or, if you like, what the preferred options of the institution are, how they would like their own translations done. And I started to get interested in this. I started to look at what literature there was on institutional attitudes towards translating, and I found not very much, actually, that in all of the literature of translation studies, there is not a great deal. Of course, I may have missed some things, and I'm sure I have, actually, and if you know of anything, do point it out to me afterwards. I'll take a list. But I found relatively little written on the texts or sets of guidelines put out by institutions that employ translators by way of advice to their own translators on how they should approach the task. There are some exceptions to this, and I will give a very brief review of what the few articles on this topic have to say. One of the people, the early people to comment on this, was Brian Mossop, from the point of view of the Canadian federal government's institutional attitude towards translation. Of course, the federal government employs quite a few translators, and it does at least offer something by way of guidelines to those translators. Mossop relates that the federal government's translation doctrine, and he's put that in inverted commas, in other words, that's what they call it, the translation doctrine, states that one should render not the words or the structures of the source text, but rather the message, or in other words, the author's intention. That's a document put out by the Translation Bureau in 1984, page 3. Okay, you might say, I uttered this phrase there yesterday, was it clear as mud? And Patrick took it up again this morning. You could say that of the Canadian government's advice to its translators. I'm not sure how much of practical use you would get out of a statement like that about translation if you were just an employee of the institution. Nevertheless, it's interesting in terms of the words that are used and the advice that is given. Elsewhere in the same document, there's a lot of reference to authenticity. A translation must be authentic, it is stated. And you may, in my comments immediately following now, want to relate this notion of authentic to authentication that we were talking about yesterday. Indeed, just for the next 2 or 3 minutes, you will, I think, find some parallels between what Theo Hermans was saying yesterday and what I've found in various things about this kind of notion. Authenticity in these texts, or at least in the Canadian federal government's document about translation, seems to mean that you mustn't give the impression that what you're reading is not a translation. Okay? The text will seem authentic if it reads as if it's not a translation. It is, you might want to pause and reflect, a curious use of the word authentic when you're saying that if something looks like something other than what it actually is, then it's authentic. Okay? You could almost parody this by saying, when is a translation not a translation? Answer, when it's authentic. But it's not just in the Canadian federal government's literature that this notion of authenticity occurs. It's actually inscribed in the Treaty of Rome, as Kaiser Koskinen 2000 points out in her article on the EU's approach towards translating. This notion of authenticity is there right back in 1957 in the Treaty of Rome. And she relates that the European Commission's translation service has a clear, albeit unwritten, preference for surface-level similarity. These are her words, Kaiser Koskinen, who has worked as a translator in the Commission. A clear, unstated preference for surface-level similarity, which is assumed to guarantee that readers of the various translations all get the same message. So whether you're reading the text in Finnish, in Italian, in Spanish, or in one of the new accession countries' languages, you're all getting the same message for us. I would adopt the same skeptical stance towards the use of the word message as Patrick adopted this morning, and I'll have more to say about that tomorrow in a paper on interpreting. Translations, we are told in the EU ideology of this, are not translations at all, they are language versions. And that is the only word that you will find on the European Union's institutions' websites to refer to the translations. They are said to be versions. That is, they are presented as if they have been drafted in all of the languages simultaneously. And sure enough, if you seek to follow, for example, the debates of the European Parliament via the website, which offers you the full unexpurgated texts of the speeches made to Parliament, you can choose your language and follow the whole debate as if the debate itself had taken place in one language, with one MEP responding to the points made by another MEP, as if it were all one language and translation were not involved in any way. Okay? Again, Koskinen relates that equivalence is often taken to mean linguistic correspondence or literal re-rendering. There seems to be that statement. She claims that it's unwritten, but if you look at the book published by St. Jerome on EU translating institutions, that's Wagner, Beck and Martinez, it's listed on the sheet that I've handed round to you. It makes it quite explicit there that there is this preference for a surface-level correspondence because it is believed that this sort of close linguistic correspondence will ensure that these are indeed different language versions, authenticated, if you like, and not translations in the commonly accepted use of the term. Another translation institution that has offered some guidance to its translators is UNESCO. And I'm indebted to Jeremy Mundy, who showed me the documents which he had from UNESCO when he worked for UNESCO as a translator, and they make interesting reading. There's a nice little book on guidance to translators by UNESCO. But as Mundy notes, the terms that are used, and you could apply this to the Canadian Federal Bureau, the federal government's advice and the EU advice, the language in which all of these guidelines are couched is, for us in translation studies, the most traditional kinds of terms, or words for talking about translation. And, of course, they are never defined. So what does UNESCO have to say? Well, it says on the very first page that accuracy is the very first requirement of translation. This is an across-the-board recommendation to UNESCO translators. Irrespective of what kind of document they are translating, accuracy comes first. You must have accuracy. They don't say what accuracy is, of course. It says that, then goes on to say that where it's a matter of translating periodicals, because of course accuracy is still of the greatest importance, there is a need for a readable text. So it must be completely accurate, but it must be readable. Okay? Now, both of these institutions, UNESCO and the EU, make a great deal of use of freelance translators. The freelance translators are given the same advice as the in-house translators, but of course the institution's ability to control what the freelancers do is much less. Although we are told that, for example, when the EU makes use of freelance translators, there is of course in-house quality assessment, quality control of all translations, and they are not issued by the EU until that quality control has taken place. So one would assume that the EU is checking translations put out to agencies and so on for, shall we say, compliance with its own preferred norms of translating and so on. So you can note the traditional terms in which all of this is couched. You can also note the vagueness of the advice, as I started with. It's not very clear what all of this means. And of course, there is a trade-off here between conflicting requirements. You can't meet all of the guidelines that are being put out in one at the same time. There is a logic in these documents whereby it must not appear to be a translation, so it's got to be readable. And it must not appear to be a translation, so there must be surface-level accuracy. And so you have, you know, readability, surface-level accuracy. You have to satisfy both requirements. And there the narrative stops. It doesn't tell you how you are going to, you, the translator, bring about this wonderful outcome of readable and surface-level accurate translations. Right. My perspective was, having looked at what meager advice there is, such as we have it in those articles that I've quoted, to then look at actual translator behavior in these institutions to see to what extent the actual translation output, it's okay, corresponds to the norms that have been put out. In other words, is there evidence, is there any evidence at all in the translations of the translators paying any heed to the advice that is contained in these guidelines? How could I do this from a kind of an applied linguistic perspective, from the kind of perspective that I've been trying to elaborate the last couple of days? Well, one way would obviously be by simply looking at lexical choice. That is, if you look at the choices translators make in the lexis they use, you might be able to gauge their willingness to depart from formal equivalence, to use Nida's old term, or, you know, surface-level accuracy. But I'm not sure that that is the most useful way of doing it. For one thing, of course, these institutions, alongside their woolly guidelines, do issue style guides and in-house glossaries, in-house online dictionaries, and so on, so that the translator, if in any doubt, is likely to consult the glossary and use whatever is the institution's preferred wording for a particular concept. In the EU, it's well known that this is the way things get done. So, leaving aside lexical choice, another way of looking at this process would be what is known in functional systemic linguistics as transitivity. Transitivity is a system which allows you to look at the way processes are presented in texts. I will illustrate this immediately, but there are plenty of people within the field of applied linguistics who have pointed out that this whole notion of the way we present processes is central to our linguistic representation of the world about us. Yes? Just a couple of quotes on this, if I can find them. Simpson, 1993, suggests that transitivity is about how speakers encode in language their mental picture of reality and how they account for their experience of the world around them. In other words, it's not a narrow process of just looking at whether a verb is transitive or intransitive. It's nothing to do with that. It is the whole process as presented in an utterance, or shall we say, in a sentence, including all of the things which surround the verb itself. And Roger Fowler, 1996, says, agency, state, process, and so on seem to be the basic categories in terms of which human beings present the world to themselves through language. Yeah. In other words, big claims are being made for this. And why should that be? Well, because it's not a narrow linguistic concept, it's a rather broad one. In Halliday's terms, transitivity looks something like this, and I've just devised this little chart. It's a very, very oversimplified version of what transitivity within systemic functional linguistics is intended to include. So, crucially, there is a process, but there are the participants in the process, and there are, optionally, the circumstances surrounding the process. So the process, the participants, and the circumstances are all part of the transitivity. Now, of course, in language, you can present a process and not refer to the participants in the process. Nominalizations are a great way of doing that. You have a verbal process, an actual transaction and action, you simply nominalize it, you present the noun as a presupposed entity, you do not have to say who is doing the action that is involved, and so on and so forth. So participants are optional, circumstances obviously are optional. In the literature, different kinds of transitivity processes are distinguished. Material processes, verbal processes, mental processes, relational processes, and others, but these are the main ones. Material processes are simply processes of doing, where you are referring, you are seeking to represent some kind of action. Typically, there is an actor and there is a goal of the action. As, for example, when you say prices fell, okay, the actor is prices, the goal is actually, that's not a good example, because it's a pseudo-agentive structure, which I'll come to later. But I'll take the other one, it's much better for my purposes. He made the coffee, there's an actor, and there is a goal. The goal is the coffee, of course, yeah. But prices fell in August is simply an illustration of circumstances in August. These processes are very simple. Simpson goes on to make a distinction between what he calls event processes and action processes. Action processes are those which involve human agency, a process for which a human being is responsible. Brings about, and event processes, which are non-animate processes, if you like. He also distinguishes within action processes those which are what he calls intention action processes, that is, those which are brought about by the volition of the actor, and supervention processes, which are simply processes which just happen, even though they still involve human agency. Thus, you could say, John swam is an action intention process, but John sank is presumably a supervention process, in that John did not intend to sink, and so on. So that's material processes. Verbal processes of saying involve the sayer, the target, and the verbiage. So she asked him a question. She is the sayer, him is the target, and a question is the verbiage. Or the forecast warns of rain. You could fit that into that framework as well. I'll move on quickly because I don't want to dwell on this stuff. Mental processes are processes of sensing, where there is a sensor and the phenomenon that is sensed. Yes? So her head ached, or she forgot his name, and so on. Finally, relational processes are processes of being or having. Yes? Where you are either saying X is Y, or X possesses Y, or possesses the property of Y, so on. So, examples like Jill was talkative, or Jill has millions, or Jill got drunk. These are all processes of being or having, and so on, with attendant circumstances which may or may not be present. Okay. So, as I said, that is a very, very oversimplified schematic view of transitivity in 3 minutes. You have to think and read a lot beyond that to get to grips with it. But as you can see, if you track this in texts and in translations, you are in fact involving most of the things that are in the text. It's not a narrow view of parts of the text. But if Fowler and Simpson and others are right, then the kind of mental representation of reality that underlies texts surfaces in texts through vehicles like this. So that was my interest in transitivity. Okay. There are problems with all of this, and this is my last thing by way of an insight from this previous paper, and then I'll get on to what I really want to talk about this afternoon. apologies for that. But a lot of people would say, for example, if you think back to Dirk De La Bastita's paper at the beginning of the week where he was talking about doing empirical research, this is obviously work that would tend towards wanting to be empirically valid. But if you're going to do proper empirical research, it really, it is argued, needs to be quantitative. In other words, you need to be able to quantify your findings. You need to be able to present percentages, statistics, and so on, and to have a valid corpus for the rest of it. Well, valid corpus, that's easy. And I put together my own corpus of texts, which were EU Parliament texts and UNESCO Courier texts, and there I have my corpus. But when you try to quantify these things, you get into big problems. They are well-known problems for those of us involved in work on translation. The first thing is that obviously there are structural differences between languages, such that there are such things as what we can call disallowed structures. In other words, you could have a structure, a transitive structure in your source text, and even if you wanted to, you cannot transfer it into the target text because it is a disallowed structure. I'm thinking of simple things like, say, in English you would say, I have been living here for 5 years, whereas in French you would say, I live here since 5 years. Right? And you can't do anything about that. So I don't even see that as a translation problem. It's an automatic, it's what Vinet and Dapernay used to call servitude. You just have to do it and get on with it, and any competent translator does it almost without thinking. I've got an example here. It's an example put forward by Mossop since I was looking at him. In French, you might find in a text, cela permet d'évacuer rapidement le personnel. And the translation of it, in this way, staff can be evacuated quickly. Quite simply because this French structure whereby you use the verb permettre to permit without a direct object is not normally allowable in English, except in texts written in English by French people. As you have noticed. Okay, so there are these disallowed structures. Now, so you say, right, so when you're going to quantify your findings here, you simply strike those out of the equation. And wherever it's a disallowed structure, you just don't count it in your count. But in addition to disallowed structures, there are what I would call dispreferred structures. In other words, there are those structures which you as competent translators recognize you could, by the grammatical norms of the target language, do as they stand in the source text in your target version. Of course, you could do it, but you know it is not a preferred structure. A simple example, and I'm taking this, by the way, from my corpus of EU Parliament translations. I find in a MEP's speech in English, the last thing we want is to do so and so and so and so, right? Translated into la dernière chose que nous souhaitons, c'est... Well, nothing wrong with that in French. It's perfectly accurate French. It is acceptable grammatically. I can't criticize it on those grounds, but I've never heard a French person or read a French person expressing that sentiment using that structure. It simply is not a preferred structure at all. These things, of course, as we all know, even if we are alert and vigilant translators, these things creep in. We don't notice them, and they are there. But if I'm trying to make quantifiable findings here, in my study of transitivity. What am I to do with these? Do I say, well, that they don't count? And if so, where do I draw the dividing line between the disallowed and the dispreferred, and so on and so forth? It's a genuine problem. Then there are, of course, the optional structures, and these are the ones that you really would want to count. That is, where there is choice, translator choice, involved. So, to quote one that I'm going to use again in just a minute, in a source text, l'Égypte conquis son autonomie, that is, literally, Egypt conquered her autonomy, political autonomy, that means, translated as Egypt came into her own. Now, plenty of translator choice involved there. That wasn't the only option. You could read off five or six or different or seven different ways of saying this in English. That's a choice. So that clearly would be in my count. But if I then count what I think to be are all the optional structures, then I run up against this final problem in quantitative terms, which is that I will be counting lots of absolutely insignificant translation shifts. And the really significant translation shifts will actually get lost in the statistics. Absolutely lost in the statistics. So, as an example here, a speech before the EU Parliament where someone is issuing condolences after a disaster that has occurred, and she says, our thoughts are with the victims. The French translation, nos pensées vont aux victimes, that is, our thoughts go to the victims. In terms of transitivity, that is a shift, right? The first is a relational process, our X, R, Y, thoughts are with victims. The other one is an action process, and they go. They move from here to there. It's an action process. But am I going to start counting things like this? If so, what is the point of the exercise that I'm undertaking? All this to say that at this stage in my research, I have not found a way of presenting quantified outcomes for my study of this, and therefore my study is entirely qualitative. I would defend that. I haven't got time to go into it this afternoon, but there is plenty of evidence that you need qualitative analyses in this kind of domain. By the way, if anybody knows of a way in which corpus linguistics could help me to isolate relational processes or mental processes in text in such a way that would be useful for analysis of this kind, I'd be interested to hear about it. But as far as I can see, that certainly software like Wordsmith tools and the available concordances and so on do not allow me to do this at the moment. Anyway, that's just an aside I will put in. I won't switch that off because I'm coming to my paper this afternoon at 22 minutes. I said I would call it The Pragmatics of Translation Shifts. By the way, my email address is up there. I don't know why it's here today and it wasn't here yesterday or the day before, but just in case you need it, there it is. But here is where I'm going to start into what I want to say. In a speech delivered to mark the launch of a United Nations initiative to preserve the ancient monuments of Nubia, ancient Egypt, in 1960. André Malraux, who was then the Minister of Culture in the French government of General de Gaulle, uttered the following as part of his review of Egypt's past. Yes, in the first half of his speech, he's going to talk about these ancient monuments. He is giving a general view of Egypt's past. And he says, here he comes again, puis l'Égypte conquit peu à peu son autonomie. Again, the convention as yesterday, I'm giving in square brackets in English a version simply to give access to the French words in the source text. I am not proposing this as any kind of translation. It is, of course, a translation, as we've been reminding ourselves all week. But don't take it in that manner. It is simply a guide for those of us who do not read French. Okay. In the translation which appeared in the UNESCO Courier in December 2001, when they were reviewing this speech, I found then gradually Egypt came into her own. Now, two research perspectives on this. First of all, we have our the critical discourse analysts, the kind of people I was talking about yesterday, including me, if you like, and we look at this from an applied linguistic annual approach and say immediately, shift of transitivity involved. What we've got here is something which in the source text is a material action intention process, that is to win something, with Egypt being personified as, you know, a human agent who can win something. They have won their own autonomy. It has become a quasi-relational process of becoming or having. Yes? As in when you say, she came into a fortune. When you come into a fortune, you don't necessarily actually have to take any action at all. You can be totally passive. It comes your way. So a relational process. So, you know, from this perspective, here is a countable instance. Yes, it is a clear transitivity shift. So I enter it into my findings. Second research perspective, cultural studies. What on earth is this splitting of hairs that these wretched linguists foist upon us, whereby they go into a text, they focus on some word or other, split it into 9 parts, and tell us that this is significant in translation terms. That's of no significance whatsoever. What is significant about this translational act is that it is the humanist ideology of a post-imperialist Western government spokesman adopted and espoused by organizations such as UNESCO and so on. And we can look at all those circumstances surrounding the text. We can build into it whatever we might want to say about colonialism, post-colonialism, neo-imperialism, you name it. Okay? So, there you have two caricatured, of course, research perspectives on this. So, the question I want to try and answer in the next half hour or so is, does this matter? Am I splitting hairs, or is there something in this transitivity shift which would make it not just worth counting, but worth paying any attention to whatsoever? So, that's where we go. In order to try and make the aims a little bit explicit, here they are. I want to revisit the notion of the translation shift from a text pragmatic angle. I'm going to introduce the pragmatics of this, and to view texts as clusters of interacting features. And here is a clue to the first part of the answer that I'm going to bring to my own question, which is that no feature exists in a text on its own, and that it's even pointless studying transitivity on its own, because transitivity interacts with other features like deixis and personalization and lexical choice and cohesion and modality and so on. And if any worldview underlying or explicit comes out of the text, it is through the interaction of all these things, not through something split up, taken away from the text, and scrutinized on its own. So that's the first part of my answer. I want also to consider translations as evidence of a particular category of reader response. In other words, one advantage that we have over the critical discourse analysts who are looking at texts in one language is that we have some very partial evidence of the way in which a particular reader, namely a translator, has responded to a text. And it is evidence of something. It is very partial evidence. It is very tantalizingly thin evidence. But there is evidence of some kind of reader response. Okay? By the way, when you're looking at the EU website and you are offered language versions in 11 or 16 languages, you have evidence of lots of reader responses. And I'll come to that in due course. So there is evidence there of something. I want also to explore the notion of the discursal shift. This, of course, is what I was on about yesterday, what I was pursuing yesterday in the Le Roi La Brie text, and so on. but it comes into what I need to say this afternoon. Finally, but I really think I touched on this yesterday, and although there is much more to be said, I suspect there will be time for it. There are methodological problems still to be explored in all of this. Okay, so if we get round to it or in questions, we can look at that.
Right.
As I said, the starting point for all this interest of mine came out of this earlier study into translation institutions. And I was struck by something which Brian Mossop had to say about translations, which I'll just submit to you now. It struck me because it seemed to me like something that could actually make the beginnings of a testable hypothesis in translation. He says, customers may well ask for literal renderings, but whether or not literal renderings get produced will depend on whether the institution's doctrine of translation allows for this approach. This is a kind of a skopos-orientated view of translation, whereby it will be the end purpose that primarily motivates the translator's action. Therefore, it is what the client or what the institution determines that will dictate how the translation is done. It also suggests, by the way, that all of those things I read out earlier about what the Canadian government and the EU and UNESCO give by way of advice to their translators, that this is actually what we will see in the translations. So I will see evidence of readability. I will see evidence of surface level accuracy. I will see evidence of these other things, and so on. So moving on from that, I undertook, as I said, this small-scale study based on a corpus of UNESCO courier translations and EU Parliament translations. And what did I find? Well, I found everything. In other words, I found many, many instances of the kind of surface-level similarity that was put in the EU guidelines, to such an extent as you would suspect the translator had almost fallen asleep and was going for dispreferred structures as a matter of course. Quite remarkable. And then, within the same parliamentary debate, almost as if one translator's got tired and another one takes over, suddenly, extreme translator liberalism, leading to all kinds of transitivity shifts, which I carefully then documented, existing side by side with this very literalist approach. In other words, I found evidence of everything happening. This confirmed the findings of Maria Calzada Perez, 2001, that's on the bibliography that I've listed there, who also found extreme shifting going on in these translations, and not quite in accordance with the evidence presented by Kaiser Koskinen, also or 2000 I think it is, who related that EU Parliament translations stayed very close to the source text. Okay. In a way, it's not surprising what I found. First of all, we noted earlier that the guidance given is very equivocal and not very clear. Secondly, it would be naive, wouldn't it, to assume that employees look to their employer's guidelines and always slavishly follow them. For example, as I was saying to someone earlier, if you look at the style guides issued by newspapers to their journalists, say this, don't say that, use this formulation, don't use that formulation, and then you do a little study of the actual articles as they appear in the press, you find there is not much observance by journalists, or for that matter, the editors of the journalists, of these style guides. So there's plenty of evidence that we shouldn't even expect some kind of adherence to these guidelines. Thirdly, and lastly, as I suggested earlier, both the UNESCO courier translations that I was looking at and the EU Parliament translations are farmed out to freelancers, and therefore they are even more remote than the in-house translators and probably feel themselves to be even less bound by the strictures of the organisation. Nevertheless, I can still pursue this from the point of view of the relative amount of shifting that goes on and whether I can begin to answer the question that I posed just now, does it matter? Is this shifting of any consequence, or is it not? Is it something we should pay attention to, or is it not? I need to just say a thing or two about how I'm viewing shifts, and I want to look at shifts in a different way from the way I presented earlier. From a pragmatic perspective, we can talk about translation shifts as anything which brings about a change to users' assumptions. What do I mean by this? Well, if you read Ernst August Gut, Translation and Relevance, or the theoretical framework within which he works, which is Relevance Theory, Sperber and Wilson, 1986-1995, you will find this notion of the contextual effect. We are told that the relevance principle is achieving the maximum contextual effect in exchange for the minimum processing effort. As I said yesterday, this is an idea that goes all the way back in translation studies to Yuri Levy in the 60s, who enunciated this principle, which he called the minimax principle of game theory. Yes, and it's a very simple social psychology point that in our interactions, in our dealings with other people, because we are all aware and we assume that each other are aware that time is limited and time is precious, we seek to achieve our communication goals as effectively as possible, but also as efficiently as possible. We need to make our point as briefly as possible and in a way which causes least disruption, least effort to our interlocutors. This is a general principle from which we will depart, of course, but we will only depart from it when we have grounds to think that the extra processing cost will be outweighed by the extra benefits that accrue. So this notion of the contextual effect are as the informational benefits brought about by something. And that's what I mean here by a change to user assumptions. Yeah? So a shift would be something which is done by the translator which shifts the set of assumptions underlying what the speaker has said for the audience that the speaker was addressing. Okay? That's still a very wide acceptation, but it has certain advantages over the traditional view of shifts. An example of this, again taken from my corpus, in a source text speech to the European Parliament, a speaker says, we refuse to produce any resources to back up this new initiative that we are taking. Right. Or, in translation, nous refusons de débloquer des ressources. We refuse to unleash resources. As you will see, the source text presupposes that the resources do not actually exist. The target text presupposes that they do exist but are not currently going to be made available. Okay? So in other words, that's what I mean by a shift to assumptions. There is a shift to our assumptions underlying that particular shift. The other difference, which is not new to me, would be that whereas traditionally the whole business of translation shifts has dealt with incidental local phenomena within text. Thus, if you go back to the beginning of the history of translation shifts, and by the way, it's a lovely summary of all this in the Encyclopedia of Translation Studies, the Moonbaker Encyclopedia, look up shifts. Kitty van Herbensvaart and colleagues have given us a really nice history of the dealings with shifts. And they start with Vinet and Dalville and Catford and all these old people from the beginnings of translation studies, where you will note that they are looking at a shift purely in terms of itself, purely local phenomenon, not considering the text surrounding the shift, not considering the circumstances of production, all these kinds of things. So from this purely incidental and local perspective, I'm moving to a textual or discursive perspective whereby the shift only has any claim to our attention in terms of its contribution to an overall emerging text or discourse and so on. Kitty van Leuven-Svart in her 1989-1990 studies was the first to embrace this text-level dimension to shifts, e.g., if the text is a narrative, how does the shift contribute to the unfolding narrative? the textual dimension. What are the vectors of these shifts as we're going to look at them? Well, they are the ones that are familiar within Hallideian linguistics, if you like. I've named them already. Things such as transitivity, we've mentioned, modality, cohesion, thematicity, that is, whatever you choose to put in theme position in an utterance shows your focalization, what you're focusing on, what it is that you want to say something about, and so on. Lexical selection, obviously, deixis, yes, and personal reference. Okay, so these kinds of things will surface in the little examples that I want to put before you. Now, I have to bore you with a little bit more theory before we get down to the data here, because, as I've just announced, I'm taking a pragmatic perspective on all of this. And I've noticed that Basil Hatim and I, and of course many others, have put out these pragmatics perspectives on translation, and we've had loads and loads of feedback. It's been very gratifying from all quarters on some of the points that we've made, some very controversial points that we've made, but the area of pragmatics is this great big silence. So, you know, it must be going down like a lead balloon, I take. So I feel incumbent upon me to say just a word or two about the pragmatics perspective, which I've already started to in talking about a goods relevance approach and so on. I don't think I have to, but in any case there's not time to go into Grice's cooperative principle, but if anybody's interested in elaborations of that, I can give potted versions at the coffee break or whenever, over dinner or whatever, at the risk of spoiling your digestion. But let me go straight to the essential criticisms that have been made of the Gricean approach to looking at language as a vehicle for our interrelations with the world about us. It has been claimed, and I alluded to this yesterday, and indeed you will find it in Lawrence Venuti's Scandals of Translation, 1998, that essentially what Grice does is elevate Anglo-American cultural norms into universal principles. That is, that what he is talking about in this cooperative principle is polite middle-class behavior in the Western world, especially between sort of English people who are very polite to each other and mind each other's P's and Q's and so on. Yes, okay. I think that I outlined very briefly a response to that criticism yesterday when I pointed out that it wasn't Grice's business to be intercultural. He simply wasn't looking at that. He was looking at how we can find a simple model to give some account for how we all understand more than the words say. And he argued there must be some simple principle underlying this, otherwise it wouldn't be such a universal feature of human communication that no matter what the culture or language, we definitely understand more than what is said or what is written. Were that not the case, everything in the text would have to be made explicit and we would never reach our threshold of termination. So, you know, it was simply that. It is easy enough for those of us interested in cross-cultural pragmatics to come along and add the intercultural dimension whereby we will say that the maxim of relevance counts differently in the Far East, Far Eastern cultures, to the way it counts in Eskimo cultures or whatever. Yes? In other words, there is always a threshold where people perceive behavior as being textually normal and where something sounds a departure from what is normal, and where there is a departure from it, what is normal, then you look for unexpressed meaning. The second criticism of Grice follows on from this, and now I'm relying on the work of Anna Wierzbicka, Cross-Cultural Pragmatics. By the way, not often quoted in translation studies, but I would say essential reading for all those of us who are interested in cross-cultural issues in texts. Absolutely crucial text. Very, very interesting volume. But she's no Gricean, and she not only makes the same point as Benuti about this Anglo-American bias, she also then goes on to say that the problem is that the meanings of which the Briceans see in their examples are actually culture-specific, and therefore they are part not of the pragmatics but of the semantics. They are therefore encoded. They are not inferred. They are encoded. She gives lots of examples. Indeed, she has a whole chapter in the 1991 book on the English expression, boys will be boys. Right, boys will be boys. The Gricean standard account would be this flouts the maxim of quantity because you are being, it's not informative. It's tautologous. It's a pleonasm. It says the same thing twice. Okay? Boys will, well, of course boys are boys. This is being less informative than is required. That's the Gricean account. But, says Villers-Biscard, that's not the way it works. Because, for example, lots of the world's languages have tautologous expressions of this kind. I'll just use one of her examples to illustrate this. She uses the English expression, war is war. And she quotes a couple of textual examples where you have this phrase, war is war. She then says similar phrases exist in all kinds of other languages. For example, in Russian. And I'd better not dare. Are there Russianists here? There must be some. So I'm not going to dare to pronounce. But, you know, the word-for-word phrase exists in Russian. But, she says, doesn't mean the same thing. Therefore, she says, it's not a matter of operating the Gricean maxim and saying this infringes the maxim, therefore there must be added meaning, therefore I can derive this added meaning. The meaning is encoded in the semantics, such that when you say war is war in English, you mean one thing, and when you say it in Russian, you mean another thing. Okay, conceded. However, I put it to you, when you say war is war in English, you can mean all kinds of different things. Right? Thus, for example, if I'm having a quarrel with somebody and I say to you, I'm going to go around there and throw a brick through his window, and you say to me, come on, you can't do that, that's over the top. I say, war is war. In other words, I say that as a justification of the action that I intend to take. Conversely, I could be commiserating with somebody, and this is actually an example of Piers Biscoe herself, who has lost a close or distant relative, and at the end of our commiserations, I might add something like war is war, where it had a very, very different pragmatic value to the one I gave in the first example. So, I actually, I'm afraid, don't buy Villers-Biscard's argument here, because yes, there are things that are encoded in the semantics, but even within a language and within a language community, it all depends. The meaning depends not on the words or the phrase, it depends on the people and how people want to use it. I come back to the quotation from Alice in Wonderland. Humpty Dumpty is actually my hero, actually. Words mean what I want them to mean, and not anything else. Yeah? And it seems to me that that is how it works. Okay. This may raise all kinds of questions in your mind, and I know I haven't argued this through. I'm leaving lots of loose ends hanging. We can return to this, as I say, over a drink or wherever in the bar. But I need to move on just now. Okay? Where have I got to? Right, I need now to get down to brass tacks. You've seen the way I'm looking at these shifts. You've seen my discoursal and textual perspective, and you've seen that I'm looking at shifts as shifts to assumptions rather than some kind of formal category like what were those V-named upending ones like modulation and transposition and all those things. Okay. Then, I use simply as an illustration from my corpus of EU speeches that I've been looking at, a particular speech delivered by an Irish MEP, member of the European Parliament, on the 6th of September 2001, in a debate about the harmonisation of mountain farming community policies within the EU. This is a debate about, obviously, the distribution of money, and whether anything can or should be done at institutional level about the desertification of those rural areas in the EU where there used to be farming communities, and there still are a few, but by God, if we want them to stay there, we'll have to bail them out because they can't make money out of keeping sheep on a mountainside and so on. So it's that kind of ambit within this, within which this takes place. Now, you now need to turn to your number one on your hymn sheet that I've given round to you. But I'm going to put these up as, I hope, if I get to it. Transparencies. At one point, the English, the Irish MEP talks about how we are going to put the ideals expressed in this report into effect. Okay? In French, we have comment mettre en pratique les idéaux exprimés dans ce rapport. In other words, the we has gone. The agent of the process, in transitivity terms, has disappeared. Let's have a look at the Spanish. ¿Cómo dar eficacia a los ideales expresados en este informe? How to give effect to the ideals expressed in this report. Likewise, the personalization is removed. You can look at the Italian. I won't perpetrate my Italian on you, but you can see the same process. Now, you're all familiar with this. Of course, we all know that English, especially in this genre of parliamentary speeches, tends to personalize. We is a preferred way of presenting the transitivity. We know that. We also know that in a whole range of languages, whereas it is perfectly possible, it's not a disallowed structure, it is partly at least dispreferred. The text, the speakers will not want to keep on placing emphasis on themselves. By the way, if I were trying to give a politeness theory account of this, I could point to the face-threatening nature of references to yourself in texts. But that's another story, which we won't go on into. So I could say, well, there's not much significance in this. And indeed, I would expect to find far less personalization in the other language texts than in the English texts. So, if I look and do a count on the whole of the Irish MEP, Mr. McCartin's speech, of first-person plural references, I find 22 occurrences in the English text, that's the source text, 16 in the French, 19 in the Spanish, 13 in the Italian, 18 in the German. That proves, that bears it out, doesn't it? That is significantly more personalization in the English than in the other languages. However, you do note the variability between the languages, and it's not entirely intuitive here in the sense that I guess a lot of us who work with French and Spanish would argue that this preference for avoiding the first person plural is very similar in Spanish, possibly in Italian too, to what it is in French, and therefore we might expect similar numbers. They're not exactly similar. More of that in due course. Okay, then we move on to see if there's anything that can be made of this. In other words, I rather like the sentence that I started with. I've set a hair running here. Does this business of the personalization, depersonalization matter at all? Well, look at these. McCartin says, we have to consider too that we will have a conflict. He's talking about EU really ought to be giving money for all this kind of thing, but of course if we do it, we shouldn't be under any illusions about the backlash that will come. Within one short sentence, hesitate to use the word sentence, I don't like it, but two references to we. How do the other languages deal with this when there is, you know, personalization to that degree? Well, my point here is, even if it's a dispreferred structure in the other languages, there is still translator choice at work. Translators still have the freedom of movement here. Thus, you find it's done one way in the French, but a different way in the Spanish and the Italian. All of them reduce the degree of personalization, but they choose different ways of ensuring that there is still some personalization. So, you know, it's not black and white here. There are different choices involved. Moreover, and I haven't produced examples to demonstrate this, but in my small corpus of these speeches, I have plenty of examples of depersonalized English source text constructions becoming personalized in French and in Spanish and so on. So translators will work in the other way. So we can't operate some blanket rule whereby we say the translators are competent bilinguals, they know that it's a dispreferred structure in these languages, so they will avoid it. That's far from being the case. Choice is involved. Okay. So the degree of personalization across the whole text, I'm now beginning to show, is reduced. Again, does it matter? Well, features don't exist on their own. This was the point that I made. And I now want to have a look at how things start to work together. The interactivity of items within texts, building up towards a textual profile and a discoursive profile. You will find somewhere in the speech, McCartin is now moving into examples. And he says, all the utilities are overutilized. He's complaining about in our towns and cities, it's far too overcrowded, whereas there are these desertified regions. It's maybe a simplistic point, but he's making it rhetorically. All the utilities are overutilized, while in other areas we are closing down public services, roads are underutilized, we are withdrawing police stations and closing down little churches and schools. Okay? You see what we are doing. At this juncture, we can note in English, but also in other languages, perhaps particularly in English in this genre, the beautiful ambivalence or multivalence of we. Who is we? It can be the speaker. You know the famous Margaret Thatcher example. Analysts always suspected that when she used we, she was referring to herself, but they could never prove it because when she said, we are going to privatize this, it could mean I and my cabinet, I and my government, or the Conservative Party, or whatever. But when she said, we have become a grandmother, then we had some tangible evidence that she actually meant herself. But anyway, you know, you can't often prove these things. So the point is, not only does this ambivalence exist in language, but there is evidence that speakers and hearers are aware of this and exploit it for their own ends. Of course they do. Yeah. So that is a point to be borne in mind. But let's have a look at how this comes out. And now I'm narrowing down and I'm just looking at the French translation. Ah. Transitivity here is changing somewhat and interacting with other features. I have put in bold print, nothing to do with emphasis in the text or anything like that, in bold print the things that I want to draw attention to. Is it legible, by the way? Yeah, okay. Modality has now crept in. We are learning that the public services have to be closed. Uh-huh. And it's not we are closing down public services, it is certain public services have to be closed. So not only has the agency disappeared, but an element of obligation has crept in. Can't do anything about it. It's going to happen. It must happen. Okay. We move on. And we find that we are no longer closing police stations. Mysteriously, the police stations are closing their own doors. This is what Roger Fowler calls a pseudo-agentive structure, well known in literary analysis, where you present a process which is normally associated with human agents and attribute it to an inanimate object. So that the churches are closing their doors. It's not people closing the doors of the churches, and so on and so forth. Okay? And I'm still at the stage of saying, oh, a couple of haphazard examples. But we go on. Getting into his stride, Mr. McCartin says, if we allow this to happen, it will be like what we did in my country 50 years ago when we closed down our railways. Yes, that is the notion, presumably in Ireland as well as in the UK, that we're beginning to regret it now. Now that chaos has broken out all over the place. By the way, if you haven't already experienced British railways, don't try it. But rehearsed phenomenon. We're going to live to regret this, and we find it will be face à la même situation qu'a connu mon pays il y a 50 ans lorsqu'il a été contraint, when it was forced, de fermer ses lignes de chemin de fer. Right. So, the reiteration of agency in the source text is, I would suggest now, very marked. It's no longer in the realm of, oh, of course there is personalization in English. Mr. McCartan is laying it on with a trowel, we this, we that, we did this, we did that, we will regret it, etc. Yes? The passivization in conjunction with the introduction of this deontic modality does more, the text is more than the sum of its parts. When these things interact with each other, they build something rather larger than just the two features on their own. And, of course, la situation qu'a connue, mon pays. Right, connaître means to experience. So it's a mental process. Whereas, of course, in the source text, it was an action process when we did something to our countries. Final example, and McCartan is now moving to his conclusion. Sorry, it's not the final example, it's the final example of we. McCartan moves to his conclusion and talks about the budgetary resources that we as a union could use towards this end. In other words, to be effective rhetorically, he needs to bring it back to be to what are we in this parliament going to do about all this. He's bemoaned the closing down of this and the closing down of that. But he needs to make his point about we need to stump up some money. Yes. So the resources that we as a union, but of course in the translation it is the resources that the union, nothing to do with us of course, that the union could allot to this domain. Right. Does it end there? You might wish it would, but I'm not quite finished. It's not just transitivity. Pseudo-agentive structures, modality, personalization, and depersonalization. There is the whole business of cohesion, and I was talking, was it yesterday or the day before yesterday, I think, about reiteration in texts, repeating things in texts, and the way in which reiterations are needed, but I suggested yesterday when they go beyond a certain threshold, they become counterproductive, or they tend to become counterproductive. But it's not that point today. It is Mr. McCartan's use within a stretch of, I counted, 100 words of running text, three times he talks about Europe or Britain being so much the poorer. At one point, Europe will be so much the poorer for that. That is, you know, closing down the railways or doing this, not saving our farming, mountain communities and so on. Britain is much the poorer for that. He relates, you'll see it in the speech if you look it up, that he spent his summer holidays in Scotland and was amazed to find the results of the highland clearances whereby where there used to be people, there are now sheep. Some of us have lived with that for quite a long while. In other words, it's not a current issue, there's can't save those highland communities anymore. But he is using it as an example, and he's pointing out that the whole country, Great Britain, is much the poorer for that, and he goes on to say, we will have a Europe that will be much poorer, and he also says, if you look at the context, and we will live to regret this. Yes? French translation. Never referred to twice in the same way. I don't want to impute motives to translators, and by the way, in all of this, I am not using this as a vehicle, a normative vehicle, for saying, look at this bad translation. I'm making no judgment whatsoever. What I'm interested in is what happens and what can happen. And I don't think, in most of the translations, I didn't find this kind of thing happening at all. But occasionally, and regularly enough for it to be worth noticing. In other words, this is not a one-off. There are other instances. So occasionally, this happens, and it all works together. And not a single reference to the reiteration here. Let me try and bring this to a conclusion. I've named personal reference, transitivity, modality, thematicity, because of course all the we's were in subject position. We do this, we do this. It wasn't so much something happens to us, it was we. Yeah, so thematicity, lexical cohesion, all working together to give a discoursal perspective, which it seems to me has changed measurably and significantly in translation. What are we then to say? Oh, a translator having an off day? A translator who is motivated by some monetarist desire to shift the politics of the EU? Hardly. I don't think so. Translators are translators. I count myself among them. And we are all subject to this. One of the things that we cannot do on the basis of the evidence we have is attribute motives to translator shifts. It's simply, there is not enough evidence to do that. We can talk about the shifts. We can, I think, with relative detachment, claim that a shift has taken place and that it is significant enough to be discoursal or textual. But to go on and then say, the translator did this because, I think is very open to the accusation, how do you know? Right? That notwithstanding, one thing that we might be able to point to is the way in which the discourses which sometimes surface in translations without there being a trace of them in the source text, very often are discourses which are ambient in the air about us, by which I mean as subjective individuals, are part of the discourses that happen all the way around us. We absorb things from television. We absorb things from the press. We absorb things from things that other people say to us. The discourses are there. We are subject to them. There's a beautiful quote in the literature about the way in which, by using language, we both reinforce discourses and are subject to them, become increasingly subject to them. It is not implausible to suggest that discourses creep into translations because translators are writers of texts, just like all other writers of texts, and are subject to the world about them. That is not attributing motives to the translator. It is just an obvious observation about the world. Farther than that, we can't go. But my interest, and I think it will be becoming apparent by now, but with the texts I was looking at yesterday and the texts today, is not in what happens in translation all the time. The corpus linguistic studies that we have are doing excellent work in substantiating Gideon Toury's norms. That is, that source text textemes tend to become target text repertories. The explicitation hypothesis. Hypothesis that in all languages and in all cultures and in all translation directions, translations as a rule tend to be rather more explicit than their source texts. And at this overall all-embracing level, the corpus linguistic studies based on masses of documents can do excellent substantiating work. I'm interested in something slightly more modest, but nevertheless I think significant, which is the way in which, not all of the time, not even most of the time, but from time to time, we find systematic things happening.